I want you all to think back to when you were in the sixth grade. Do you remember who the fat kid was in your class? When I was in school, that kid was me. And I want to tell you my story. The first time someone commented on my body was when I was a toddler. I was 3 years old. At a doctor's appointment, the doctor told my parents that something must be wrong. A child shouldn't be that big. They ran several tests, and to everyone's surprise, they came back normal. They sent me home and told my parents to put me on the diet. This was the first time I received the message that my body wasn't okay the way that it was. Throughout my childhood, I refused to wear shorts or dresses that cut off above the knee. I went to sleep with shirts, hopeful that if I covered myself up enough, no one would notice me. By the time I was 8, I'd been on countless diets, been to a myriad of Weight Watchers meetings, and even gone to weight loss camp. The people around me had no qualms about commenting on what I was eating or what my body looked like. At family gatherings, relatives would tell me that, you know, you probably shouldn't have that piece of cake. Or acquaintances at the grocery store would stop my parents and say, you know, I've heard about this new diet that you might want to try. Go try it. These things did nothing to help me. I would lose weight and then gain it back again. And instead made me incredibly self-conscious about my body. 3 years old, I had weight loss surgery. When the other kids in my class in the fifth grade were enjoying their spring break, I was having a bandage around my stomach, giving up the capacity about the size of my head. Initially, some people would say that they could consider the surgery to be a success. I lost some weight, and that was what we wanted after all. However, I ended up dealing with several complications. I would spend hours getting sick after trying to eat. I remember getting violently ill and thinking to myself, you deserve this. This is what you get for being so fat. Unfortunately, I ended up in this unlucky in-between zone where I could still eat enough to binge on ice cream and cookies and that sort of thing, but also to still get sick on a regular basis when I try to eat foods with any nutritional value. So of course, once again, I continued to gain weight. And so I did what I'd always been told to do. I went on more diets. But I never thought to question why I felt the compulsive need to keep eating, or what was going on with myself mentally instead of physically. I suppose it shouldn't come as a surprise then that as a socially awkward and obese adolescent, I became severely depressed. I would get home from school, study, and try to cope with my feelings, at least temporarily, by eating copious amounts of food. Of course, I would feel intense shame about this. Then I'd go into the bathroom and I would harm myself in an attempt to relieve these feelings. My sophomore year of college, I decided that it was time for me to seek treatment and address these issues. I went away, and when I came back in the spring semester, I decided that in addition to addressing my mental health, it was time to improve my physical health as well. I called it my lifestyle change. Initially, everyone around me was incredibly supportive. I had the best of intentions. I figured, lose weight, get healthy, find happiness. It's all that simple. And people were finally noticing me, or at least they were finally noticing my body. They didn't notice my sunken eyes and my pale face. The look of terror when I would black out yet again if I tried to move quickly or do anything. They asked me my secret, or the number of calories that I was eating, but I knew that I couldn't tell them the truth. I couldn't say the lies that I was telling my friends and family, that, you know, I have such a kind of a big breakfast, so I'm not really that hungry for lunch or dinner. Or when I slept through dinner yet again, that it wasn't that much of an accident. When people said, so just how many calories are you eating? I wondered what they would say if my response was, just enough to know that I won't pass out today. At this point, I didn't look like someone who had an eating disorder. No one was concerned because this doesn't look like the face of someone who's anorexic. At this point, I went and saw a doctor for the first time. She told me that I was damaging every system in my body. She ran blood work and said that I was malnourished, not a place that I ever thought I would find myself. She began telling me the ways that I was harming my health, saying that, what if I passed out while I was driving and ended up in a deadly crash? Or the muscle in my heart that was wasting away, what if it stopped working? I stopped her and I said, I know I probably shouldn't say this, but I just don't care. At that point in my life, I would rather be thin and dead than spend another moment in a body that I so desperately despise. I spent hours each day looking myself apart in the mirror and stepping on and off the scale dozens of times. I convinced myself that happiness was just another 20 pounds away. So my junior year, I found myself back in treatment, this time deciding to address my needs. The biggest obstacle for me in early recovery, as well as all the times that I relapsed, was in accepting my body unconditionally. The idea that my body in its current state didn't need fixing, didn't need changing, that I was just okay the way I was. This was a big challenge for me, but throughout treatment, it was something, an idea that I really tried to embrace. I decided, rather than punishing my body for all the things, why not celebrate the things that it can do for me? I spent so long hiding it and telling myself, I'll finally do things once I'm good enough, once I feel confident enough. So, a lot of things that probably wouldn't seem like a big deal to most people were a pretty big deal to me. I went ziplining for the first time. I went indoor skydiving, and I even wore sleeveless shirts. So I got pretty excited about this, and I decided the next step was to buy a bathing suit. I hadn't gone swimming in years. The last time I had, I'd gone fully clothed in my knee-length jean shorts. And I figured if I'm gonna do this, I might as well go all out and get a bikini. So I went to Target and grabbed a bunch of bikinis off the rack because I had no idea what size I was. The fluorescent lights in the dressing room highlighted every imperfection. Every bump and bulge, every scar and stretch mark. And I looked at myself in the mirror and I said, you know what? I'm okay with this. And if someone else has an issue, that's their problem. I'll admit, I got a little overexcited. I took a picture, or 10. And I decided, in a moment of excitement, courage, and perhaps slight disillusionment, to post it on Facebook. I put a lengthy caption describing my personal struggle with my body image, and culminating in me buying my first bikini. I turned off my phone when I went into group therapy for the next couple of hours. I returned to find a flood of messages from people that I knew well and people that I didn't know at all. They told me their story and how much they could relate. It was really exciting, but after a few days, the excitement wore off. I kind of forgot about it and moved on. So imagine my surprise when a week later, I got a text message from my sister. It contained a link to People Magazine's website, and there I was, in my bikini. Up until this point, the comments and feedback I received had been largely positive. It seemed that the people of people.com had some different opinions, though. I scrolled down to the first comment. This poor girl, this woman said, she'll just never be satisfied with herself. It seemed this woman had missed the entire point of my post, but I told myself, that's okay. There's always one. I kept scrolling. The next comment read, Orca in the pool. I questioned whether I should laugh or cry, but I kept going. I'll have to say my personal favorite is probably the one written by a commenter who called himself Fuzzy Dolphin. He said, this chick can successfully parachute out of a plane without the parachute. This was his way of mocking the excess skin I had as a result of losing weight so rapidly during my eating disorder. Initially, these things stopped. They got to me, and I repeated their comments over and over in my mind. People said things like, this girl needs plastic surgery, or she looks more like a 60-year-old than a 21-year-old. And I began to question, is this whole body positivity thing just kind of sham, some kind of sham? My way of convincing myself that I'm acceptable the way that I am while the rest of the world looks on in horror at my body. And I realized it didn't matter. I would take the freedom that comes with letting myself live any day over the misery that I had trying to get my body to fit an impossible ideal. So I'd like to share some information with you. About 60% of 10-year-olds have been told that they're too fat. Of those kids, by age 19, they're significantly more likely to be obese, regardless of whether they were overweight to begin with. There's a reason that 4 out of 5 children are afraid of becoming fat, more than they are of getting cancer or both of their parents dying. Where are we sending, why are kids getting the message that it's okay to make fun of the fat kid in the class? We have this idea that someone who's underweight and has an eating disorder is sick. They need treatment and they need help. Of course they do. But someone on the other end of the spectrum is simply lacking willpower, a failure, someone who can't stick to a diet. And there's this idea of health at every size that so many people seem to be critical of. Why would we want people to think that they're okay with the way that they are when they're actually living an unhealthy lifestyle? Well, we seem to have this idea that if we shame people enough into feeding themselves, that they'll magically become healthy. And that doesn't happen, as I can say from personal experience. In fact, children who diet are 12 times more likely to end up binging, which results in them having self-esteem issues, developing disordered eating patterns, and ultimately gaining weight, which is the opposite of the often intended result. So, I've had a lot of therapy, and let's be real, I don't have it all figured out. There are still days when I look in the mirror and I think to myself, maybe if I just lost a little bit more weight, I would be happier and I would be okay with myself. And it's the same voice in my mind that's telling me that I'll be worthy as long as my weight stays below a certain number. It takes a lot of time to get past the idea that our weight equates worth. It takes a lot of effort to undo this message. It doesn't happen overnight, and it doesn't happen over the course of a year of treatment. So I want you to know that if you want to comment on my body and tell me that I look so much better now than I did when I was 300 pounds, that's okay. But you need to be willing to listen to, because even the fat kid has a story to tell. Thank you.